moving Carol forward. Together. To keep updated on the COVID-19 pandemic in Carroll County, go to carrollcountymd.gov/COVID-19.
So, good morning. Sorry about that delay. As I said, Ed had to jump off. He is over and is working on, he's got his major meeting this morning. So he wanted to be on to say thank you to Beth, but I had to jump off. So you're getting me again for the update. But I do have some interesting things to share today. So we updated the graphs a little bit with our epidemiologist just to give you a little bit different, fresher view of some things, although it all looks about the same, that the numbers are still continuing to climb. So here's our first graph, which combines it's total cases now, which we have been looking at the community cases in the beginning, but I really feel with the facility cases going back up a little bit, that it's better to look at the total cases. But this has the probable cases added in. I know we've kind of wanted to just see what that looks like visually. The probable cases have also been increasing over the past several weeks. And so we wanted to be able to show you in the same graph, the two together. As you know, the probable cases don't count as confirmed cases, but we do treat them as positives. They are contact traced. They are asked to isolate and all. But this way it just kind of shows you what the, this is in addition to those true numbers, those total numbers that you see on the website are those probable cases. Next, I just wanted to isolate the probable cases and just remind everybody that they're, even though they're not counted, we are, we are following up with them. These slides are posted every week on our website, and so I try to include a little more information on them so that folks who are just reading them can understand what the information means. Here's our rolling average. You can see that we had that little dip last week when we had a little bit of a reduction in cases, but it's, we're going back up now. The ICU beds in use, I haven't been super elevated, but as you had mentioned earlier today, the hospital, as Commissioner Frazier mentioned, the hospital is seeing a lot of COVID cases and really kind of the impact of COVID now, locally. So we're going to be sharing some extra hospital data soon, but, this is just the one thing we've been sharing consistently, so I wanted to still include it. We also have some hospitalization data next. This data we haven't been sharing recently because it was not being updated very consistently, and we didn't feel like it was accurately reflecting what was happening. This is not what's happening at Carroll Hospital. So we all talked about that, and there's a little more information about that. But this is what's happening to Carroll County residents in terms of the number of residents who are being hospitalized for COVID. There's a little bit of a data lag, so that's why I think it's a little bit lower this past week. But you can see just by the wave that, in the last several weeks, there have been more Carroll County residents hospitalized for COVID. It's only one hospitalization per person, so it's not counting people twice if they're hospitalized twice. It's just if anybody in Carroll County was ever hospitalized for COVID. So as I said, you can see it's not really a real time, but you can see that in the last several weeks, there have been more hospitalizations of people in Carroll County. So this is COVID deaths by week. We also tweaked this graph a little bit to show you still the facility deaths and the community deaths separately, but I wanted to stack them to really give a better visual for how many deaths we've really seen over the last few weeks in total. So you can see, obviously, it's much lower than that original spring, in the spring when we had so many facility deaths. But you can still see that facility and community deaths combined have given us a little spike in fatalities. Our age range was getting so packed, we couldn't really see the lines anymore. So we took out several weeks and just started in mid-August. And so you can see here a little bit more clearly the different, sort of the variations in the age groups over time. And then here's the other age graph, which gives you a little bit another sort of time view on a horizontal axis, but just showing you those different groups. And just to note, these groups are not the same, not all the same size. So there are different, different numbers of people in these groups. And these are just sheer numbers. So it's not really a rate. Oops. I also wanted to mention the vaccination survey. I've been saying that I would bring some results. So I have a few results from the vaccination survey, but anybody has any questions about the data, we can do that first, and then I'll go into the survey.
Anything on the data? Pretty much speaks for itself.
It does.
I know that the daily reports we're getting out of CHC are very troubling as well. So appreciate the, the sharing of that too, Maggie. I think Ed had spoken with Garrett out there that we're going to try to do that on a little bit more consistent basis just to get the sense of where we are here, especially in the next month or two.
Yeah, yes. So we'll be sharing the total census, I believe, and then the number of COVID patients and the number of PUIs. And the number of COVID patients in this past week has been in the 30s, whereas before previous weeks, it's been in the maybe upper teens the last couple of weeks. So it's definitely higher this week, the number of COVID patients in Carroll Hospital. And so we're watching that pretty closely and just, and hopefully, yeah, we'll be able to share that a little bit more clearly in the coming
few days. Are you familiar with, what is the ICU bed capacity at Carroll Hospital? Is it 14?
It may be 14 of the spreadsheet that I see every day. It's usually like a 12, but I think it's around 14 total, but it's like 12 normally beds that they normally see. And as I said, with our ICU graph, we were seeing some real upticks there, but I haven't in the last few weeks, but it does seem like they have more COVID patients. So I think they're just not all of them are in the ICU. A lot of them are in acute care beds.
Okay. Thanks.
Well, I take away the positive from this amongst all the negative is thank goodness we're not seeing the spikes in fatalities in relation to the spikes in infections like we had in the spring. So that's a positive we can take away from this. And the fact that we're not seeing as many people in the ICU, I'm really curious to find out, you know, medically why we're able to bring that down. It's good, but whatever we're doing that's right, I wish we could expand and inform people, because I'm very happy to see that the spike is not taking place in the fatalities. That was my biggest concern, that we'd see that fatality spike like we had in the spring. So whatever's going on, there's some positives out there, and I'm very grateful to people and the medical staff that are making it happen.
That's a great point. Yeah, we have not seen quite the same spike as we did in the spring, but of course, you know, a lot of those fatalities were in, you know, very vulnerable populations in facilities. And, you know, we're seeing that a little bit of it again. I mean, I'd say we have a spike. It's just a much smaller spike than we've had before. But we're thankful to, all the healthcare workers who are doing their best to care for people. And, you know, the medical advances that people in labs and people who are studying these things have found, trying lots of new treatments, that certainly helped. I think, you know, keep the fatality rates down, but it's still, you know, it's still concerning. Obviously, the best way to prevent fatalities is to prevent infections in the first place. So that's our first line of defense is prevention, but we certainly are grateful for everybody who's worked hard to reduce the fatality rate over time. So any other questions about the data before I give you a little information about the vaccination survey?
No, I think we're good.
Okay. All right. So, So the Maryland Department of Health did just release a frequently asked questions document. It's pretty long, pretty thorough. We'll be putting that up on our vaccination page today. So folks can look for that, and that will be updated regularly. Now that we've gotten the results of this first survey, I will be working on making sure that we are able to answer a lot of the questions that that residents raised in this survey. Certainly had some great questions. A lot of people, you know, are interested but want to know more, and so we want to be able to give them that information as soon as it's available. So we'll be working a lot on getting out more information about vaccination, you know, over the next few weeks and as much as we can in the coming months as we all learn more. So as I said, I'll be posting the results on this website in a few minutes after this call. And folks who did not get a chance to take the survey, we did close the large survey, but if anybody's interested in taking it still, I did open up a second wave of the survey because there are so many people who are still interested. So people can contact us. There's information on that page, or they can give our the hotline a call and get more information about how to take the survey. So these are just a few slides from the results. A lot of the results are, you know, very interesting. One of the things I find most interesting about these surveys is just the comments people make, because they really tell you what people want to know and what their concerns are. So. So this first question we asked was if people would get a COVID vaccine as soon as it was available to them, you know, based on their priority group. And about half said that they were either definitely or probably planning to get the vaccine as soon as it was available to them. And about 35% they said that they would probably not or definitely not get it right away. So that helps us a little bit in planning, just to know, you know, who's going to wait and see, who's never going to, you know, who really doesn't want to get it and who definitely wants to get it as soon as possible. So if you're not sure, we ask people, why are you not sure? And this was pretty interesting. So a lot of, you know, the biggest concern, people could answer multiple, you know, could choose multiple reasons, but the biggest concern was side effects. The second biggest concern was safety. The third, that the vaccine wasn't tested on people like that, people of the same race or the same age group or the same health conditions. The fourth was that the approval process was rushed. They're concerned about the approval process. And the fifth was effectiveness. And then we also asked what would make people decide to get the vaccine at a later time. And this kind of echoes what was said in the previous question, evidence of safety, evidence of effectiveness, evidence in people who like them. A lot of people said that if their doctor recommended it, they would strongly consider it. And some people did say if it was a requirement, they would get it, but they might not get it otherwise. And then the last question I want to share was, in what ways would you be comfortable receiving the vaccine when you choose to do so? And this is just helpful for us in planning how best to get the vaccine out to the community. And almost 80% said they'd be comfortable receiving it from their healthcare provider. Over 40% said pharmacy, drive-through clinic. A lot of folks comfortable getting it from their employer like they often do with a flu shot. And then folks clinics with appointments. So that will help us as we move forward and learn what vaccines we're getting when and how we can get it out to the public. It'll help us to know a little bit more about what folks would like to see. So any questions about the vaccination survey?
Interesting. Very, very interesting results, Maggie. That's all I can say about it. Again, you're a little over 10,000 folks that took it. So
yes,
and the survey's still open. Is that what you said?
So the first survey isn't open since I had to present the results, but I had enough people who were interested that I've made a second survey, so folks can contact me and find a way to take that. I'm happy to talk with somebody over the phone or send it in the mail if they really want to take it, but aren't able to take it online. So people can still take it if they want to. We're obviously, this is a long haul. We're going to be planning and distributing this vaccine for quite a long time. And so we're happy to get any feedback we can from the community.
Okay.
So, and as I said, those results will be available on our website, and they're including some of the interesting comments that I think will really help us plan and communicate about the vaccine as we move forward. So okay. That's all I have. Just reminding people again to, help move Carol forward by taking all these steps that we all know by heart by now. We will have a video coming out hopefully later today. That's a really positive, just kind of a thank you video to thank everybody for all the work they've done. I think Carroll County is still really, doing well considering, the rest of the state and the rest of the country. And we need to just continue to do that and continue to watch out for each other and protect each other by taking all these steps.
Okay, Maggie, I know today we all have heard that the there could be a decision by the experts on whether or not the vaccine. I think, Dennis, you mentioned that.
Yeah.
As we get ever so closer there, I know that there are procedures and a process in place that you all at the health department have put together working collaboratively with all of the partners around the county. So there is a process in place for that. And is that something, will that process be shared, or how do we anticipate advising our citizens on that particular adventure that we're going to be entering into?
That's a great question. The big vaccination adventure. Yes, we will be sharing more information about that. It's a little tricky because, as we've said before, so many moving parts and so many things are changing that our plans have to be very flexible. So it isn't like we can say we're going to be doing this week and this next week and this next month. We're really trying to be flexible and really waiting for guidance from the state and from federal government in terms of how many doses we have, which vaccine we're getting, how it needs to be stored and things like that. And so a lot of variables still, but we do want to share more about the process. And I think now that once we have a little bit more information about which vaccine we're getting, we'll be sharing more information. Right now, as I think everybody probably knows, that first wave will be going to long-term care facilities and some of those first responders, healthcare workers. That plan is in place with our community partners, and you know, there's a lot of flexibility built in there, but we're already starting to work on those parts and getting those groups, figuring out who needs to be vaccinated, how many people, and how best to do that. So that's in the works. But in terms of when we open to larger groups and we have more vaccine and we're starting with those sort of second level priority groups, we'll be sharing those plans in advance so people can really prepare and know what steps they need to take to get on the list and to when to show up and things like that. So that will be shared as soon as we have more information.
Okay, excellent. And just a reminder of the testing capabilities that you all have at the Shipley Arena again, and the number to call.
Okay, so our number, 410-876-4848. You can also go to our website and sign up. It's great if you're working with your provider, but you don't have to have a provider's order to get the test. We test on Sundays, Tuesdays, and Thursdays from 9 to 12. We've opened extra spaces, so hopefully most folks can get in. There's still a lot of demand, but we certainly ask that people plan in advance if they can. Not everybody can, but if you can, and to let us know if you can't make it, because those open spots will hopefully be used by somebody else.
Okay, so, anything else for Maggie? Okay, thank you, Maggie.